Hello, fellow students of Jewish history. Let us continue with this new episode of the Jewish History Lab by looking at a very important document at the turning point of Jews in the early diaspora. The creation of the Jerusalem Talmud is what we're going to talk about specifically today. Let us recall, as we discussed in previous episodes, the destruction of the temple happened in the year 70 in the context of the Great Revolt, the first Roman-Jewish War, you know, a tremendous amount of persecution directed at the Jews, particularly in Judea, around the region of Jerusalem, right afterwards. This is followed by a smaller revolt called the Kitos Rebellion that actually is widespread throughout the Eastern Mediterranean, and then a much larger revolt in the year 132 under Bar Kochba. All of these revolts are unsuccessful, and the Roman Empire just rolls right over them, although with tremendous amount of difficulty, particularly in the case of the three-year Bar Kokhba revolt. Jerusalem is declared off-limits to Jews. Judea itself, the region in the hill country, is largely denuded of Jews, as many of them flee to the north, in particular ends of the coast. Jerusalem itself is renamed Aelia Capitolina, and Jews will only later be allowed to visit their capital city on rare occasions, like the 9th of Av, the date in which the temple was destroyed in the year 70. Very, very strong backlash against the Jews in the 2nd century. However, there's a lightening of the load in the 3rd century that's temporary, but it allows the Jews in the region of the city of Tiberias in particular to kind of reconstruct themselves and bring themselves back to a sense of a single administrative and spiritual purpose. And this brief period allows the new center to emerge in the Galilee region. Ultimately, however, this brief honeymoon in the 3rd century would end, and by the time you get to the middle of the 4th century, there's once again tensions between the Jewish population in the north this time and the Roman authorities. There is an uprising against them in the year 352, which the Romans crush mercilessly. Ultimately, they would even destroy the last remnant of political authority of the Jews, the office of the Nasi, or the Patriarch. That would end in the 420s. But during this period, amazingly, there is this foresight that is applied to the notion of creating something that would allow the Jews to exist in diaspora. And that major creation is what we call the Jerusalem Talmud. So that's what we're really going to focus on today, is try to understand what exactly is this Jerusalem Talmud. It's amazing to think about the circumstances in which it is written, but let's focus primarily on the document itself. What is this with the name Jerusalem Talmud? If you were paying attention in the last couple of minutes, you know that the Jews were actually barred from living in Jerusalem and only gradually allowed to even visit Jerusalem a little bit later on. Why would we call this the Jerusalem Talmud? And the reality is, it was not written in Jerusalem. The text is almost completely composed in the city of Tiberias in the north. And a lot of scholars presume that sections of it were also composed on the coast in the city of Caesarea or Caesarea, and also in Sippori, also known as Sepphoris in English. And so it's called the Jerusalem Talmud. It's kind of a misnomer, probably because it's a more familiar term than the term that was used for it in the Babylonian Talmud. It's younger sister, the Babylonian Talmud would refer to the Jerusalem Talmud as the Talmud de Ma'arava, which means the Talmud of the West, of course, the West of the region of Babylonia, or Talmud de Eretz Yisrael, the Talmud of the land of Israel. For a long period of time in Western historiography, it's been referred to as the Palestinian Talmud. Of course, right up until really the 1960s, this was very, very common. But once the nationality known as the Palestinians became much more defined and the consciousness of a people who called themselves Palestinians became much more au courant, then it became sort of awkward to refer to the Talmud as the Palestinian Talmud. But you will see in older scholarship it's frequently referred to that way as well. So at any rate, all of these names have some challenges to them, but it was not written in Jerusalem, even though it's nowadays called the Yerushalmi or the Jerusalem Talmud. What exactly is the Jerusalem Talmud? So First of all, we should understand what is the Talmud. There are two of them, the Jerusalem and the Babylonian Talmud. They are basically extended discussions by hundreds, even thousands of rabbis and occasionally non-rabbis, non-Jews, women, but primarily rabbis, talking about what the Mishnah means. Now, we've discussed the Mishnah in previous classes, and I don't want to go into great detail here, but that's basically a massive six-volume statement of Jewish law that expands upon and clarifies passages in the Bible that require additional elucidation in order to actualize them. One quick example, for example, on the holiday of Sukkot, the Bible says that, you know, Jews are supposed to celebrate with a palm frond and a goodly fruit, pre-Eitz Hadar. And so the first question is, what is a goodly fruit? What is a beautiful fruit? I personally like those really big navel oranges. But if I walk to shul with one of those big navel oranges on Sukkot, you know, people would look sideways at me. The real fruit is an etrog, kind of a lemon-like plant called a citron. And the Mishnah is where we get this oral Torah that explains a lot of these ambiguities. There's a lot more to say about the Mishnah. Please go back and watch the video there if you want. So the Mishnah itself, although it represents a tremendous advantage in clarifying how Jews are actually supposed to live their lives in all aspects of their, you know, experience of the world, both in terms of, you know, their ritual lives, their financial lives, their civil lives, and all kinds of things like that is dealt with in the Mishnah, it still requires much more discussion. It is an open-ended oral document. And so the Talmud, also known as the Gemara, or the finishing, is basically the transcript of these massive, long conversations about the Mishnah. And they can go on in many tangents, very far from the original text of the Mishnah as well, but that's essentially what the Talmud is. It's kind of like an expansion of the Mishnah, or at least it is a huge conversation about the human condition that begins with a discussion of the Mishnah. The principal figure behind the Jerusalem Talmud is without doubt the incredible Rabbi Yochanan. He also had a very fascinating chevrusa or study partner named Reish Lakish. And the two of them in particular sort of coordinate much of the discussion that happens, although it really involves hundreds of rabbis who pitch in their opinions about one thing or another. It is eventually codified into a fixed text that will become the Talmud itself. The text also includes lots of documents called baraitot or baraisas. These literally translate as outside texts. These are texts that are much older. They're the same age as the Mishnah, but they didn't make it into the Mishnah itself. So it really expands the clarification of the Mishnah by saying, here is a fragmentary literary piece that tells us a little bit about what the Mishnah actually meant and so on. There are some scholars who argue that the tangents in the Talmud are so big that in reality it should be considered an independent work, not essentially an elucidation of the Mishnah. I remain unconvinced. It seems to me it's still very, very rooted in the Mishnah, but at any rate, God willing, you can all explore the Jerusalem Talmud your own and discover what you think about that debate. At any rate, that's basically what this text is. When was it written? So as I mentioned, it involves hundreds of rabbis. These rabbis are called Amoraim, which means the speakers or the sayers. And they are distinct from the generations associated with the Mishnah, who are called the Tanaim, which means the teachers. And it involves like six generations of them, including at least three generations of scholars from Babylonia who also get involved in the conversation. And the conversations extend basically from the closing of the Mishnah, which would be in the early 3rd century, right up to about the year 400. That's when the text is more or less closed, and we have the Talmud Yerushalmi in its current form. So how does the Jerusalem Talmud compare with the Babylonian Talmud? If you have a look at this map here, you can see in the circle on the left, that's where the Jerusalem Talmud was largely composed, and the circle on the right is the region of Mesopotamia, where most of the Talmudic academies were located in Babylonia, and that's where that was composed. So there was a significant amount of communication between the land of Israel and the land of Babylonia. It's kind of like a long trek around the Euphrates River, but you would have people making that trek backwards and forwards, and they would be sharing ideas and discussions from their respective academies. The Jerusalem Talmud, however, is the older sister. It started probably a little bit earlier, but it certainly finished earlier than the Babylonian Talmud. The Jerusalem Talmud is generally smaller. It tends to have much more material proportionately dealing with halakha or Jewish law than it does with agarata or philosophy, legends, things like that. The Babylonian Talmud tends to have a proportion that gives a little more weight to the agarata. There are a few chapters in the Jerusalem Talmud which are completely lost. Part of the reason for this is because the Babylonian Talmud received a lot more attention for most of the Middle Ages, and unfortunately, some manuscripts seem to have just simply disappeared. There was a fascinating footnote in the early 20th century when a scholar came forward and claimed to have discovered them. In reality, however, after he generated a tremendous amount of excitement, it turned out he didn't discover them. He actually wrote them. They were forgeries. There's a lot of fascinating things about that, but not for our discussion today. But the Jerusalem Talmud and the Babylonian Talmud have a tremendous amount of overlap. They're basically one shared tradition, one shared purpose of trying to understand the Mishnah, but they are expressed in two distinct literary communities that have a certain degree of communication with each other. In the Talmud Bavli, for example, there's frequent references to, for example, the phrase Ki Asa Rav Dimi. When Rav Dimi came back from Israel and shared with us what he learned there. So in the Talmud Bavli, they're saying, oh, isn't it interesting that they say this over there in Israel, and they discuss that for a while. And it happens as well to a lesser degree in the Jerusalem Talmud. Ultimately, however, the Talmud Bavli lasts about 100 years longer before it becomes codified, somewhere around the year 500. That's one of the main reasons why the Talmud Bavli was much more well-studied than the Talmud Yerushalmi, because it represented kind of like a later update, a more recent software, if you will, to the older version. Both of them are written in Aramaic, although there's a significant dialectical difference between the Western Aramaic spoken in Israel and the Eastern Aramaic spoken in Babylonia. They're largely understandable to each other, although the orthography, the spelling of some words, looks really bizarre if you're used to the Babylonian Aramaic and you switch over to the Yerushalmi, but they're largely understandable to speakers and readers of Aramaic. I think one of the most fascinating aspects of the Yerushalmi is what the Germans called Rezeptionsgeschichte, which means the reception history. How was this book appreciated? How was it adopted? How was it sometimes ignored, and so on? There's no question that the Babylonian Talmud, for the reasons I mentioned a moment ago, received precedence and much more pride of central place in the minds of most Jews through the Middle Ages, right up until the modern era, really. This was actually stated explicitly by the Gaonim, the great rabbis of Baghdad, for example, Rav Chai Gaon, who died in the year 1038. He said we should pay much more attention to the Babylonian Talmud when it contradicts the Jerusalem Talmud, because the Babylonian Talmud, being written later, as it were, had more evidence at their disposal, more time to think about things. And so the Babylonian Talmud is the authoritative one. Why would you study the text, which is not the authoritative one? That's one of the reasons why the Babylonian Talmud really took much more precedence in those areas where Jews lived, where they were heavily influenced by Baghdad in particular. That would include Spain and Provence, for example, and by extension, the Ashkenazi lands of France and Germany. So that really gave the Babylonian Talmud a huge edge. But there are some areas which tended to have a much closer attachment to the land of Israel intellectually and in terms of its literary tradition. That would include, for example, Italy and North Africa. And it was there that the study of the Jerusalem Talmud was largely preserved. By the time you get to the period of the Rishonim, around the turn of the millennium, you have great figures like Rav Alfasi, known as the Rif, who began to kind of resuscitate the study of the Jerusalem Talmud as a tool to understand difficult passages in the Babylonian Talmud. And of course, this would become much more prominent. Tosfot would also do the same kind of thing as well. Well, they'll say, we really want to understand the Bavli, and oh, here's a difficult part. What does it say in the Yerushalmi? And they'll look back there to see how that improves the Bavli. It is kind of like the Jerusalem Talmud had become a value add to the Babylonian, but it was not independently studied. So unfortunately, what this meant was that no manuscripts, except for one important one called the Leiden manuscript, actually survived the Middle Ages. Almost everything else is fragmentary. Little pieces of the Jerusalem Talmud survived here and there, but only one full manuscript. It was copied in 1289, and the scribe actually said he thinks it's filled with mistakes, but you know, he's doing the best he can, and this is the manuscript that forms the basis of the Jerusalem Talmud that would later be printed in the early 16th century, the Editio Princeps, which was based primarily on the Leiden manuscript and a couple other versions as well. There is some significant promise that extensive study of the fragments in the Cairo Geniza may restore lost passages here and there, but it remains a very challenging Talmud to study, primarily because the text is not nearly as well worked over and as reliable and as cross-checked as the Babylonian Talmud was. The Jerusalem Talmud was kind of like the forgotten sister for much of its history. Very, very few commentaries were written on it, nothing like what was written on the Babylonian Talmud. However, in the post-war period, with the expansion of popular programs like Daf Yomi that really elevated the study of the Babylonian Talmud, this a lot more scholars are turning their attention to the Jerusalem Talmud as well, to the older sister. And there is many, many more renewed students. There was recently completed a massive 51-volume English translation of the Jerusalem Talmud by the Artscroll Foundation, an absolutely remarkable work of scholarship. And so the Jerusalem Talmud may be getting much more attention now that we entered into a new technological era. I hope you found this video useful. Those of you who follow the series know that the reason I call this the Jewish History Lab is because I'm preparing these videos alongside the writing of a 3-volume book of Jewish history, a survey that goes from the earliest times right up to the modern period for Koren Publishers in Jerusalem. And so if you are interested in following along, I really appreciate your attention. Please like and subscribe. And if you have something to offer in your comment section, I'd love to see what you have to say. And I just want to say thank you very much for watching this video.